In fact, in my presentation, I show many pictures from the inside of the books just to show the images of this game. I mean, the gruesomeness of this game and the occult link to it.
Well, I know that when I did my message, and this has happened, I have letter after letter where people took the pieces. Now, there's sixes involved in the pieces of the game, but they'd take the pieces of the game, they would throw them in the incinerator or the fireplace, and screams would come out because there seemed to be some kind of spiritual forces inhabiting those pieces, and children would drop out of life. They didn't want to study anymore. What are the pieces, for instance?
Well, this game...
Hi guys, Harbs, Narbs here. Welcome back to the third episode of my series on the history of the Forgotten Realms in Dungeons & Dragons. Today we're going to be taking a look at 3rd/3.5 edition, and if you haven't seen the first two episodes, then the links are in the description below. Okay, let's go. It's the year 2000, a new millennium in the world computers didn't turn on us with Y2K.
The year 2000 computer bug as a worldwide crisis, and one of the most serious and potentially devastating events this nation has ever encountered.
TSR, the original creators of D&D, are no more and were bought by Wizards of the Coast in 1997. Wizards were then bought by Hasbro in the year 1999. Hasbro then saw it as fitting to put out a new edition of D&D. A new century and a fresh start for the world's greatest role-playing game. The first notable change was that they dropped the word advanced and went back to the original Dungeons & Dragons, believing this to be more marketable. The other major thing that they did was create the Open Gaming License. This was a licensing opportunity for Wizards of the Coast, as Ryan Dancy, the then vice president of Wizards, believed that D&D's strength lay in the community that played its games, and that maybe they shouldn't keep every card so close to their chest. Therefore, Wizards released the OGL, which allowed creators outside of Wizards to use the official D&D system to make their own publishable content. It's a reason why DM's Guild exists today. Now, the reasoning behind this move was that if lots of people are producing content for D&D, then Wizards can take a cut and it will encourage people to buy the three main books being produced by Wizards: the Player's Handbook, the Monster's Manual, and the Dungeon Master's Guide. Anyway, the licensing stuff isn't very interesting, but that was a major change for D&D. So, 3rd edition is in full swing and everyone's creating content for D&D, but this gets some quick restrictions on it after the Book of Erotic Fantasy is released, it was only a matter of time, and Wizards then changed the OGL so that creators have to abide by decency rules. There are obviously still strict copyright laws around Wizards' IP, even if they themselves didn't actually create any of D&D's iconic creatures. They do make it clear to this day on their website that they will unleash the Demogorgon on you for any breach of copyright. And what this means in real world terms is that they will sue the shit out of you. However, the OGL was a welcome addition nonetheless, and is something that creators can still use today, within fairly strict boundaries given that they can only sell their work on DM's Guild. By the way, I'm no lawyer, I've read about the OGL and the system reference document, and I find it all a bit confusing. So, what were the major rule changes in 3rd edition? Well, charisma was made a more important skill, now affecting the spellcasting of some classes. Race restrictions were lifted, meaning any race could be any class. Believe it or not, in older editions, dwarves couldn't be paladins and elves couldn't be druids unless you homebrewed your own rules around them. Weapon restrictions on clerics were lifted, and challenge ratings were also introduced. A thing that players enjoyed more in 3rd edition was the customizability of classes, as there was something introduced called Prestige Class, which, dependent on the feats you had chosen or your membership of a particular group, you could effectively have a decent subclass. Now, in the same year as 3rd edition was released, the Dungeons & Dragons film came out. If you haven't seen this film, then you should know that it's been nominated for several awards. Worst Picture, Worst Sense of Direction, Worst Supporting Actor, Worst Supporting Actress, Worst On-Screen Group, Most Intrusive Musical Score, Least Special Effects, and Most Unfunny Comic Relief. You'll be delighted to know that it didn't actually win any of those awards, because luckily for Dungeons & Dragons, Battlefield Earth also came out in the same year. To be fair to the Dungeons & Dragons film, it was originally supposed to have a much bigger budget, with a much more prestigious director, but the selling of TSR to Wizards put a stop to all of that. Somehow the film ended up being directed by its producer, Courtney Solomon, and its budget was reduced to a $3.5 million. But to be fair to Courtney, he did raise an additional $30 million for the project through investors. It's a shame really, this guy seemed super passionate about the film and it could have been so much more. I wonder if Jeremy Irons regrets his role in it. It should be mentioned that this film is not set in any specific campaign setting. Apparently it was loosely based upon Mystara, however. So, what was going on in the Forgotten Realms during 3rd edition? Well, in 2001, the same year that Halo and the Fellowship of the Ring were released, the 3rd edition Forgotten Realms campaign setting was published. There were some new changes to the setting, including an increased prominence of the Red Wizards in various cities across the realms. The Red Wizards were from an area of Faerun called Thay, and there is a stereotype that every wizard in the land of Thay is a Red Wizard. Well, this isn't the case, and only a very few select individuals are. Traditionally, they are ruled by a group of Zulkirs, who each are in charge of a school of magic, the most powerful of which is Saz-Tam, the Zulkir of Necromancy. And whilst in 3rd edition he has not seized total control of the country for himself, this does happen in later editions. They actually have really fascinating lore, and in 3rd edition they are spread out throughout the realms, and we can see in the 3E supplement, Lords of Darkness, that the Red Wizards have started to build an economic empire, selling their magical wares across the realms. However, this was only a guise, and they were building huge revenue streams for their other sinister plots. It wouldn't surprise me if we see the Red Wizards of Thay in Baldur's Gate 3, given that recently they have found themselves working with the Githyanki in 5th edition, and as purveyors of great magic and regular summoners of demons and devils, their presence in the game would be fitting. A mysterious group called the Shadowvar was also added in 3rd edition. These were a group of strange wizards that had been literally banished from the entire planet of Toril for 1,700 years. Their city, Thul Tantar, was moved into the Plane of Shadow by Telamont Thantul. Now, the city of Thul Tantar was a Netherese city, which was part of an ancient megacratic empire. I've spoken about them before in previous videos because we see them briefly mentioned in Gale's background story in Baldur's Gate 3. However, Telamont was in a 2014 book called The Herald, written by Ed Greenwood. This book details events of the Second Sundering and how the floating city of Thul Tantar was sent crashing into another city called Mithdrana, and its leader Telamont was defeated. Telamont was involved in a plot to raise Shar to be the new goddess of magic, but he subsequently failed. Therefore, as this book is set only about 10 realm years or so before Baldur's Gate 3, the Shadowvar will surely get a mention in the game, considering how much Shar stuff we can already see in Baldur's Gate 3. Oh my, these Forgotten Realms names. Forgotten Realms lore is great for its evolution. Something is created in one edition and they can be expanded upon in future editions within the passage of time. Sometimes with a few inconsistencies though. So, the 3rd edition started in 1372 DR and ended in 1376, but there was no defining world-shattering event just before the edition. 2nd edition was at the end of the Time of Troubles, 4th edition was technically during the Spell Plague, but the campaigns were set after the Spell Plague, and 5th edition was just after the Second Sundering. 3rd edition had nothing like this, but let's look at what happened in the Forgotten Realms during 3rd edition realm years. In 1372, Lolth, goddess of the Drow, falls silent and stops granting spells to her worshippers. This happens in the novel series War of the Spider Queen. In 1373, Bahamut, the dragon god of justice, was freed from his ancient prison. In 1374, clergies of Cyric and Shar worked together to attempt to create a hole in the weave in order to make a magic dead zone, as detailed in the adventure Cormyr, the Tearing of the Weave. In 1375, the ancient Fae capital of Carador rises from the waters of the Murloc, and finally, in 1376, Mordok Salanmir attempts to use the Onyx Tower to destroy Baldur's Gate with his undead monsters, as detailed in the game Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance 2, which I think is canon. Anyway, it's fair to say that every year in the Forgotten Realms is a bit like if you're Harry Potter attending Hogwarts. It's a terrible and downright horrifying experience where death and total chaos is literally around every corner. Strangely, in 2003, Wizards released a 3.5 edition, but it was well needed, and the revision was seen as a good thing by most players, as 3.5 edition had more balance. A lot of skills, spells, and classes were adapted, some more than others. This was an important move by Wizards who were actually listening to their fanbase, so it came as a shock when, in 2008, Wizards released one of their worst creations thus far, 4th edition. But that's for next time. Thanks for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this video, then do please give me a like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Bye!
Dungeons & Dragons emphasizes black and white witchcraft. It creates a world of fear and death. Dr. Gary North says, Dungeons & Dragons is the most effectively, most magnificently packaged, most profitably marketed, the most thoroughly researched introduction to the occult in man's recorded history.